Okay, so maybe I need to mention this here again. I'm going to assume specifically that my beta t, the sequence, they are increasing with beta 1, first element is going to be greater than or equals to 1. So I am going to construct a confidence set, right, using CT. To define the CT, I need BTs. I am just saying that BTs are all increasing with beta 1 being greater than or equals to 1. Okay? Okay, fine. So let us now do regret analysis for this algorithm. So what is the regret? It is going to be in round t. The regret in a particular round t is going to be this much, right? Okay. So let me write it. So this is nothing but max. So regret in round t. So I am just going to use this notation r small t to denote this quantity r small t, and r capital T is nothing but summation of all r t's. Is that fine? So rt is nothing but max over d theta star minus whatever you played dt into theta star. So this is nothing but dt star theta star minus dt theta star. So I am just denoting theta star to be what? The one maximizes this. Notice that this dt star is different from this dt that you have played in that round t, and that is this dt here. Okay. So now this is nothing but dt dt, right? It is just this. So now let us focus this. What is this quantity? This is nothing but, I am just going to put it as, this is nothing but, I am just going to replace this UCB value again by this quantity here, what I have written here. So this is nothing but argmax of max of theta belongs to CT times d theta t. Right? I have just replaced this UCB quantity by this quantity. What it is basically doing? It is maximizing this product, treating both of them as variables over theta as well as d. What such program is called? This is an optimization problem, right? Is it a linear optimization problem? No, right? What is such optimization problem? It is a bilinear optimization problem because both are variables for you. You are trying to optimize both over theta as well as d. It is a bilinear optimization problem. Okay? So now let us denote by theta dt and theta So sorry, I have to make this t minus 1, right? Okay. I am going to use what is that, the way we have defined CT should be? I think CT only you are going to use all the quantities. This is fine. I am now going to denote it as t and tilde. So whatever the pair d and theta that maximizes this quantity, I am going to denote it as dt and theta t tilde. Is that fine? So this dt, or which maximizes this, I already written is at dt, and the theta which maximizes that this quantity, I am going to write it as theta t tilde. Okay, so this is the maximizing pair. This theta t tilde, does it belong to Ct? It belongs to Ct, right? Because that is where it is chosen from. Okay. Okay. So now let's try to understand this. So before I write this, is it true that if I write it as dt times theta tilde minus dt theta star, is this correct? What I have done is, this is the inner product between dt star and theta star, right? I am saying that this is dominated by dt theta t star, theta t tilde. Is this true? Why is this? I have already said that this pair dt theta t is the maximization over all possible ones. Okay? And notice that I have already used the fact that this guy Ct contains theta star. This guy contains theta star. So because of this, this pair should be dominated by this pair. Convinced? Okay, fine. So now this is nothing but, I can write it as theta tilde minus theta star. Yeah? That I have assumed, right, with high probability, right? As of now I am assumed. Yeah, that I have assumed. So we have to later show that it is indeed possible. I should be able to construct such a set where theta star belong to Ct with high probability. Okay, so I have assumed that, that is why I am safe here. Okay. Okay. We are going to do one more manipulation here. What we will do is, to this we will just add and subtract. So simply I have added and subtracted theta hat t minus 1. What is this theta hat t minus 1? This is the estimate I am going to get about the theta star in round t minus 1. Okay. So now let us simplify this. This is nothing but, so you will see that why I am doing all these manipulations here to get it in some certain required format. So what I will now do is, so I am going to club this and this and write it as theta t and theta t tilde minus theta t minus 1 hat plus theta t times theta t minus 1 hat minus theta star. Is this correct? It's the same thing, right? This is, I have just taken this minus this and then this minus this and plugged it here. Both of them are getting multiplied with theta. Oh. Okay. Okay, so now let us focus on this term here. Okay. So the first term here, Can I write it as, this is nothing but by definition, this is theta transpose, and what I will do is, I will deliberately get this term here. And similarly, the other term. This is fine, right? I have just done nothing. Nothing, I have just inserted a matrix and multiplied by its inverse. So, nothing changes. Okay. So, now what I will do is, so now this is nothing but inner product of these two vectors. Dt transpose Vt minus 1 is an another row vector. This matrix, let us say assume its inverse exists, and then by this column matrix. So, this matrix into this column matrix is another column matrix. So, this is nothing but product of these two vectors. Okay. I could also do the same thing for the other, but let me only just continue with this guy. So, by the way, what is Vt minus 1? So, it is nothing but we have say lambda I plus summation ds transpose ds. Okay. So, now I am going to apply Cauchy-Schwarz. Now, we are going to apply Cauchy-Schwarz. So, apply Cauchy-Schwarz. What are you going to get? Dt transpose Vt minus 1 norm of this times norm of so, okay, just let me see this. We need a square root or no? This norm is enough, right? And this is the L2 norm. So, is this similarly, I can do it for the other also. Vt minus 1. Yeah. Oh, this is fine, right? What is the issue? No, that will come, that is the next step. As of now, it is just like this is one vector, this is another vector, and this is the norm of that vector, this is the norm of the second vector. Yeah, so if you want to do it the other way, just if you get make it a column vector if you want. But it does not matter, right? It's a row vector or a column vector. The norm is still going to be the same. Its norm is going to be. So now, what is this? This is nothing but dt inner product. Wait a minute. So this is nothing but inner product of dt with Vt minus 1 with itself, right? I mean, so right now I am messing up with columns and row vector, but this is one vector, this is another vector. Okay, and similarly, this is also inner product between Vt inverse theta t minus theta t hat times Vt inverse theta t theta t. Is this correct? So, norm of a x is nothing but inner product of x with itself, right? I am just So now I need to have a square. Okay. Do I need it? No, I don't need it, right? Like this is already a squared sum. Why you need it? Why you need a square root here? Yeah, but say here. Okay. So I think I should have squared here also, right? I should have squared here.
That should also be a square root.
Yeah?
R greater than 1. Then the squaring is allowed.
Okay. No, that's fine. Let's see. Just let's see. So let's understand this. If we have an inner product between x transpose and y, so this is nothing but what? Summation xi yi. And what now we are saying is this is upper bounded by sigma xi square and sigma yi square, right? And what is this giving us? This is giving us, if I just say like this, this is just a square sum. Yeah, then I need to have a square of all of this, right? So what is this quantity? This is now nothing but x transpose x, right? So this is up square root of this, right?
Yes. First term is like the square norm of x.
Yeah, this is like norm of x. Yeah, squared and norm of y squared, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's go with this. We need to have a square root here for this consistent upper bounding. Let's take this. So now I'm going to write this as this quantity here. Can I write it as dt with again, it need to have a square, okay? And then what is this other quantity? This is going to be theta tilde theta hat with respect to v t minus 1. So this is t minus 1 and inverse. Is this correct?
Squared,
yes. Till this point it is correct. We have just like by definition norm of dt with respect to vt minus 1 is exactly this definition. So okay, now we know that this is nothing but simply dt vt minus 1 and this quantity is again nothing but norm of theta t theta hat vt minus 1. Minus 1. So you notice that this one I got it for the first term, okay? So I can do a same thing, everything remains same, right? Except that my theta t tilde is replaced by theta t hat. So if I do the same business here, I am going to get this extra term. Yeah.
So if you open that inner product involving dt transpose vt minus 1.
Yeah.
So that is going to be like dt transpose vt minus 1 times vt minus 1 transpose times dt.
Yeah.
So that is now this norm would be with respect to vt minus 1 times vt minus 1 transpose, right?
So what are you saying? These are not correct, same? Okay, let's see this. So what is this? So this is what by definition is this is nothing but inner product between these two, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
So then
to open this.
Okay, let's open this.
Yes. happens. So it will open as dt transpose.
Dt transpose.
Vt minus
1. And then?
Vt minus 1 transpose.
Vt minus 1, okay, you want to, you are just taking the transpose of this, right, first? Or
this
okay,
this
is already a row vector, okay? And then I want to take the transpose of this.
Yes.
So I am going to get Vt minus 1 transpose dt.
Yes.
And what is this by definition? This is the same quantity, right?
So we didn't have a Vt minus 1 transpose. When you define this norm with respect to
this. Okay, so okay, fine. Let me write this. So this is nothing but dt times v t minus 1 and
dt transpose vt minus 1 dt.
So this is what we have defined it, right? Okay, fine. So there is this, there is a difference between these two. So let me see.
Vt minus 1 is symmetric, that we know.
Yeah. So let me see. Suppose if I do this, nothing changes, right? I mean, I will do that also similarly later there. So this is also half, and this is also half. Then this is half, half, and then this is, I just keep it Vt minus 1 only here. So now everything is fine. Yeah, fine. So that is why this is going to be the same. So because of that, if you are just going to, so what is this? This is half, and this is another half with transpose, but that will give you back Vt. So is this fine?
Because this is a semi-definite Vt, only therefore we could define that root.
We could define that
root because eigendichot.
Yeah, this is PSD, right? So we, all the eigenvalues are going to positive. So I'm which line you are talking about, where otherwise what we could have done? This is fine, right? So usually this kind of we are going to define this norm with respect to a matrix if this matrix happens to be a positive semi definite or positive definite. So positive definite. So in this case we already know that this my matrix Vt is already positive definite. Okay. So is this now all fine? Okay, so now let's focus on these parts. Now let's come to the big assumption I have made, where I have assumed that this one I said theta minus 1, right? These are all theta minus t minus 1. Why I have not written t minus 1? Okay, so this is all t minus 1. What I know, okay, so I should be a bit careful here. What I want to do is, I want to take the minus on its side and I want to take the plus on this side, okay. So this is minus minus, this is plus, this is going to be minus, this is going to be plus, and this is going to be plus here. Is that fine? I have made this minus and this is plus. Because of that, this is going to be everything is fine. I have just replaced Vt by Vt inverse and this by Vt, just Vt without inverting it. Okay. So now let's go back and see what our assumption says. We have assumed that what is my Ct? The Ct kind of I have assumed that it is going to be of this form, right? Theta. Such that theta minus 1 hat is going to be upper bounded by what? Beta t. Now can I replace upper bound this quantity by beta t? Because I know that this quantity is upper bounded by beta t, right? Can I also upper bound this quantity by beta t? See, notice that the difference between this and this is theta t tilde. But it is still in Ct, right? Theta t is still in Ct. So I should be able to still bound that quantity. This quantity is also by both this and this quantity by beta t, right? So now that's why I'm going to write it as 2 times norm of theta t dt minus 1 inverse times beta t. So we had, I think earlier we had this square, right, the way we have defined. Then I am going to upper bound it by what? Square root by beta t. Okay. So now what is this? Now finally what you have arrived is rt is upper bounded by this quantity, right? After all this manipulations and applying our exploiting our assumptions, we are able to show rt is upper bounded by 2 times this naughty dt norm with respect to vt inverse and square root of bt. So now let's see, I want to now make another manipulation. I know that rt is upper bounded by 2 also. Why is that? I know that by my first assumption, I know that this mean quantity is there at most 1, right? Absolute value of this is for each d is upper bounded by 1. So the claim is then this quantity can be at most 2, right? If this is 1 and this is minus 1, then I am going to get that upper bound, right? So in any round, that is why my regret can be either at most 2 or upper bounded by this quantity. Is that correct? So rt is upper bounded by min of and further I have assumed that this quantity beta t are increasing and they are at least 1. So that is what I will also pull that out. So this should be beta t square root of min of 1 times I mean just assume that if I replace this 1 by upper bounded by beta t, then I will just pull out that square root of beta t, then I am going to get it. So finally, I have been able to reduce my rt to this format. Okay. So now it all boils down to, I know that I have already known, assume that this is some sequence. So now the quantity is how to bound this quantity. This depends on the observations I have made so far, right? So how to bound this quantity? So now let's focus on this. Okay, now the claim is this quantity here. So what is now rt? Rt is nothing but summation of these quantities, right? Now what is this rt? Is nothing but summation of rt, t going from 1 t. So this should be nothing but upper bounded by 2 times summation square root of bt. And what I will do is further, I will also make it square root bt, b capital T, because I know that bt sequence is increasing, right? I will take the largest value of that and then I am going to make it as minimum. Then it is going to be sum I equals to 1 to capital minimum of 1 norm of dt vt minus 1. Is this correct? Now claim, we are now going to argue that summation I equals to 1 to t min of 1 comma dt vt minus well, inverse, it is going to depend on my I matrices like this. This is going to be log of determinant of Vt divided by determinant of V0. So now what we are basically connecting is basically how this norm of this depends on the determinant of my vectors I have observed so far. So let's quickly try to get this how why this is true. So then we are actually now going to use some linear algebra and matrix algebra here. So first I'm going to use this property that is always upper bounded by 2 log, this is log to the base e here actually is 1 plus u. Is this inequality correct? This equality holds. So if you are going to take u between 0, 1, then minimum of this 2 is going to satisfy this. Okay. So now let us try to apply this inequality to this quantity. Okay. So I am going to take one term here. So this is this is t here. So then min of 1 dt dt minus 1. What is this quantity is going to look like? So okay, first before I could apply this, I should argue that this norm is going to be between 0, 1, right? If I can use that, then I can use this quantity and bound it as 2 times log 1 plus norm of dt dt minus 1. Okay. His question is, suppose if u is already between 0, 1, right? So then why not this mean of u, my u comma 1 is just u, right? So why is this? Okay, just let me just check this, what I am doing is correct. Yeah, so let us say let's try to ignore this part. So let us say u is positive. Let us try to verify that this holds always. Okay, so let us take the simplest case when u equals to 1, this is 1, this is anyway this holds. Now yeah, so then this, and in that case it is going to be always greater than 1, right? So that is fine. So log, just check what is the log 2 to the base e. After 2 multiplied, I mean this quantity, right? 2 times this for u equals to 1. So that is greater than 1. So that is fine. So I think maybe I do not need this actually. Okay. Now then I really do not need to worry about what is this quantity, right? This is some positive quantity I know. Okay. This positive quantity with this holds. Okay. Now what I am interested in, this going to t 1 to t. So this is going to be t 1 to t. So now if I can just write it as 2 times log of e product 1 plus norm of dt vt minus 1 this, and where this is now t equals to 1 to capital T. Okay, so just sum of log, I use this log of product. Okay, so fine. So let's take this inequality, let's keep it like this. Now I'm going to write my Vt. I can write my Vt to be iteratively like this, right? Plus Dt transpose D. dt dt transpose. If I do this, so just see whether this is correct. So I have taken Vt to the power half on the left side, and then again I have taken Vt to the power half again on the right side. So if you just multiply this, it is just the numerator, right? It is just this. Okay. So if I have a matrix C which is nothing but product of two matrices A and B, what is determinant of C? It is determinant of A and B, right? So I let's use this. Determinant of Vt is equals to determinant of Vt minus 1 half times determinant of this entire quantity. And then determinant of Vt minus 1 half. Okay. So this you can pull out, and now this is nothing but determinant of Vt. Now let's focus on this part. This matrix, if you just look into this, this has first identity matrix I plus, now look into this. So this part, it's a vector. This part is also a vector. So now it is just nothing but outer product of two vectors. So okay, so let's focus on this. This is of the form determinant of I plus y, y transpose, where y is the things I have put it in circle. Okay, so do you know what should be the determinant of such a matrix? Okay, so what should be the eigenvalues of such a matrix? So okay, so you can just go and compute. So the eigenvalues of such matrix are 1 and, so eigenvalues here are, what would be the rank of this matrix? So eigenvalues are going to be 1, and another eigenvalue is simply going to be 1 plus norm of y 2. So it will have only these two eigenvalues, and these are the two values. Okay. So if I know these are the eigenvalues, what is the determinant of this quantity? It is just going to be the product of these two values. That's why I'm saying, how, what is the rank of this? Yeah. One eigenvalues will be this, and how many ones will be there? D minus 1, rest are all 1, 1, 1, 1. So only this is the only, these are only two distinct ones. This one will be repeated. Okay. So you can check this. Now determinant of sub Vt is nothing but determinant of Vt minus 1 times, what is this now? This is nothing but 1 plus this quantity here, norm of Vt minus 1 half times dt square. But we know that this is nothing but what? By definition, this is nothing but 1 plus norm of dt vt minus 1 inverse, right? This quantity here is nothing but this, okay. So now, yeah, let's try to quickly wind this up. So I have this. Now what we have done, we have iteratively written determinators of vt in terms of determinators of vt minus 1 and into this quantity. So go back and check that this indeed correct, like these are all eigenvalues of this metric. Right now we are just writing. So if you just compute this, this is going to give you determinators of vt is equals to determinant of v0 times product of these guys, right? Agreed? I have just written iteratively. I have now replaced determinant of vt minus 1 by the same equation. So it will give me finally determinant of vt equals to determinant of v0 plus product of these two terms. Product of these two terms, all these terms, okay, should be s here. That is going from S1 to T. Okay, fine. So now let's go back. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. Okay, maybe we'll just drop this. So now if you look into this, what I have? The product of this is nothing but determinant of vt divided by determinant of v0, right? So if I am going to have a product from t equals to 1 to capital T, this is going to give me what? What was this? This was like min of 1 comma norm of dt times vt minus 1 inverse. So this is nothing but 2 times log of E determinant of V capital T divided by what is going to be determinant of V0? Lambda multiplied by how many times?
Lambda to the power
D, right? Whatever it is. Okay, fine. So I have this quantity now. Okay. So finally, now let's try to find out what is the determinant of vt is going to be. If I can bound this last term, then we are more or less done. Okay. What is going to be determinant of vt? Determinant of vt. So what is going to be the rank of this matrix vt? It is going to be full rank, right? This is a positive definite matrix. Okay. And in that case, what is its eigenvalues? All of them are going to be positive, and if I am going to multiply all of their eigenvalues, what I am going to get? The determinant, right? So this is nothing but this is going to be a determinant. So what are lambda is here? Are the eigenvalues of this matrix Vt. So how many of you know GP AP inequality? Geometry progression, arithmetic progression. Can you apply GPAP and tell me what should be the bound for this? So what is the AP? Arithmetic progression of this. This is nothing but D or
D.
Okay. So now let's do another round of simplification. I equals to 1 to d. What is summation of lambda I? What is the sum of eigenvalues? Can you connect it to the trace of a matrix? It is going to be what? Trace, just going to be trace, right? So this is going to be Okay. So now what is Vt? Vt is nothing but V0 plus other quantities, right? So I know that Vt is nothing but V0 plus what is this? Each one of them is a matrix. How they will look like? So if you are going to look at their diagonal values, they are squares, right? Like each component squared, the diagonals where each component is squared. Is it true that trace of this is nothing but the trace of each one of them? So this is nothing but trace of V0 plus summation of trace of ds ds transpose for s equals to 1 to t. This whole thing divided by d. What is trace of d ds transpose? Norm of ds, right? Squared norm. So this is going to be upper bound, right? So sorry, this is nothing but trace of V naught. What is
d lambda?
D lambda, right? Because there are d elements getting added lambda times. Now this is nothing but norm of ds squared. This is sum, right? 1 to d. This is divided by d whole to the power d. S equals to?
1 to t, capital T.
Yeah, right. This is S equals to 1 to capital T. Followed? So now, okay. Now let us appeal to our second assumption. What was our second assumption? Norm of S is less than or equals to L, right? So let us apply here. What this gave me? This gave me d lambda t times L whole divided by d to the power d. Yeah, first d get cancelled. Okay. So now finally what we have shown is this quantity determinant of Vt is upper bounded by this quantity here. Okay. Yeah, this is square here. Okay, because that is norm square. So fine. I don't know which portion I need to erase. So let us continue to erase here. So now what is this? I have finally able to bound as this is 2 times log Vt is this quantity, right? If I take a logarithmic of this, this is going to be 2d times lambda plus TL by d. Okay, so did I miss? Now what is this denominator is going to give me? So what was the determinant of V0?
Lambda to the power d,
right? So where, how does that come now? So that d will come out of this and there is a lambda here, right? Inside the log only, right? It is already inside the log. So this is going to be 2d log 1 plus tl by lambda d. This is what we have got. So TL square. Now the assumption is the squared norm is L. Okay, we just said, just check whether we said on the squared norm or just the norm, right? If it is, let me see what I wanted actually. Yeah, so this is L square. Okay, so fine. So let's finish this now. Okay, can somebody tell me where was the, what was the bound I had? So if I remember correctly, I had RT is upper bounded by summation 2 beta T summation T equals to capital T min of 1 comma dt. Bt minus 1 inverse, right?
Root bt,
okay. Now what I have shown finally, this quantity here is bounded by this quantity, right? So this is now 2d square root of bt times log of 1 plus T L square by lambda T. Oh yeah. So there is so before I think I have made a small mistake. So let me see if what is that we had said, this dt is equals to rt, right? What I wanted to basically use is, so the bound we had on rt, what is the bound we gave on rt? Okay, there is some issue. So I want to actually do this 2 summation 1 and then rt square, and I wanted to bound rt square. I don't know what is that rt. This is dt square here. Okay, just a minute, hold on. So fine, as of now let's take, for time being we are done with this this bounds. Okay, so okay, let's conclude this. Let's say till this point we are correct, right? If I am going to bound this minimum of these two quantities, this is the bound I am going to get. Okay, so let's take another 2 minutes and finish this, otherwise we'll have a discontinuity. So what is this RT? RT is my RT over T equals to 1 to capital T, this, right? And what I showed earlier, this RT is what, this is, we said this is upper bounded by 2 times square root of bt times, what is that, min of 1 comma dt bt minus 1, this whole quantity. Okay, so now let's find, so I know that this quantity here, no, our analysis is correct. I think this part was just like I didn't put the things correctly. So this part here, I am going to treat them as like this. If I am going to treat this, is it true that now I am going to get a summation of 1 and summation of RT square? Okay, so then this is nothing but square root of t times summation of rt square. Okay, and now whatever we got here from this to this point, so what we had this as just for dt or dt square, I think that is our mistake. We had it as dt square. Can you check this step? No. When we actually proved this is product is equals to this determinant, right?
Yes.
Was that norm of dt or dt square? Can I just verify that? I think that is supposed to be dt square. It should be square, just check that. That is why it is messing up. It should be dt square. What is that? Yeah, here also, yes. Yes. So, see, that is why this whole of this works if this is dt square. I think this is the mistake we have made. This is actually this. Now, is that fine? So, just verify that. Let's quickly wind it up. So, now we have rt is upper bounded by what? So, this is why. Because we have only bound on this dt square, I can't directly apply whatever the values I have. That's why I am trying to get this quantity in terms of rt square. Okay. So now if I have this in rt square, now what is this? This is now square root t square, and then still it is going to be 2 times square root beta. I'm now going to, I have made it the largest possible, right? I have made it beta capital T, and now this is going to be square root of summation t equals to 1 to t minimum of 1 comma norm of dt square dt minus 1 inverse. Okay, so is this correct now? So now this is nothing but square root t square root t, this is beta t. Now on this I have a bound now, which is this quantity here. This quantity is what? (2d log 1 + t) λ² / λ d. So what finally I am able to show is my regret bound rt is upper bounded like this. So if you see this, right now I have not told anything about how the square root beta t looks like. We will talk about it next time. But at least if you assume this beta t is fixed, you will see that this regret bound grows like square root t. And also there is one more t here, but that is inside the log term. So the dominant term here is going to be square root t. Those beta t term here, they themselves grow like in d, square root d. This beta term, they also grow in d. So later when you plug in that value, this is becomes square root d, but there is another square root d term here. Because of that, it becomes like d square root t. So right now let's just only worry about now in terms of, so now we have a bound which goes like square root t. So now later when we plug in the value of beta t, then we will worry how it depends on the other parameters. Okay, you see that already, like this kind level, that this analysis is different from how we did the analysis for our standard multi-amp bandit, right? So now it is using lot of linear algebra and matrix manipulations. It's because our assumption that my reward function is linear. So, because of all this linear algebra has kicked in. Okay, so let's stop here.